And to add, I'm glad to greet you at the Ukraine Crisis Media Center, and I'm thankful to everyone who came to the Ukraine Crisis Media Center. And political discourse is returning Crimea. This question is important, and before our discussion, we will watch a documentary, Indigenous People, and I'm giving the floor to Veldar Shukudzhiev. He will tell us about this documentary. I know that a big team of enthusiasts worked on the documentary. I'm excited. My Ukrainian language is not very good. The documentary, the idea of this documentary appeared when I first time listened to Ms. Belitzer lecture in Kherson on indigenous people, and understood that Crimean Tatars knows little about their rights for Crimea. Of course, Crimea is the territory of Crimean Tatars. It is our native land, our motherland, but some details we don't know them. And then I was a member of one training in session in Lviv organized by Crimea SOS NGO. I was invited, and there at this workshop at round table discussions governmental representatives and NGO representatives gathered at the roundtable discussions, about 35 panelists, and they talked about administrative territorial division of Ukraine, and I asked about the occupation of the Crimea and further model of Tatars. Mr. Sadovy, he started to sort over. He started from Afghanistan, Syria, 11th September in the USA. So I understood that he didn't know the topic. Then I asked the same question to Olya Dukhnich and Pavlo Kazarin. Olya answered in a diplomatic manner, and I understood that she knew this topic, and the topic is close to her. Pavlo Kazarin answered, in summary, the occupation is good, but no autonomy will be granted to you because it will cause separatism. Well, good then. After 3 or 4 days, I met a good journalist, Mustafa Nayem. He is a famous journalist in Ukraine, and I asked him, after 30 seconds, he was silent. I understood that he was thinking. He was thinking how to answer. Then he answered, could you tell me when the day of the occupation of Crimea took place? We thought of the Second World War and the First World War. The most optimistic people among us, they even remembered the referendum. he sought the day of deportation. He meant the day of deportation, May 18th. Then I understood finally that this documentary should be shot in order to give understanding the rights of Crimean Tatars in Crimea, existence of Tatars. This was how this film was born, and now we are presenting the documentary. You are welcome to watch it.
Наразі спробуємо розібратися, що знають пересічні
українці. Let's try to find out what ordinary Ukrainians know about Crimean Tatars, what are their rights and what status of future Crimea they see. We would like to ask ordinary Ukrainians these questions. What are indigenous people of Ukraine, Ukrainian, Crimean Tatars, Georgians, Jews, and many others, many other people. Ukraine is a multinational country. Many nations live in Ukraine. First of all, this is Ukrainian, then Crimean Tatars, and that's all. How do you think the country should ensure the rights of indigenous people? Well, if we have some indigenous people, we will have the country. I don't know how to answer this question. Every citizen of Ukraine, regardless of his nation, nationality, he should be protected, despite of his nationality, whatever it is. Of course, every person should receive support. The state of Ukraine should care about the people living, residing in its territories, and ensure right for information, for adequate life, for education, adequate standard of life. I don't know. Indigenous people should have the right to have own language, own land, and freedom. So, what does it mean, indigenous people, and what indigenous people live in Ukraine? Indigenous people live in multinational societies of countries. In Ukraine, indigenous people who do not have their own countries are Crimean Tatars, Karaims, and Krimchaks. All of them live in the territory of Crimea. Ukrainians is a nationhood, the nation which forms the country, the rest of people. They have national countries separately. Karaims is a small nation from Crimea, according to the census of 2001. 701 Krimchak people live in Ukraine. They are Jewish Tatars. 280 people live according to the census. census, Crimean Tatars, they are most numerous, 245,291 people. This is more than 20% of the population of the Crimean Peninsula. They have their own anthem, and they have structural bodies of power, Kurultai and Mejlis. Kurultai is a national assembly represented by nominees which reside in the territory of Ukraine, and Crimean Tatars and family members of their families, regardless of their place of residence. The period of members of Kurultai is 5 years. They are responsible for social, cultural, political issues. Mejlis, Kurultai takes decision on formation of authorities of Crimean Tatars. Mejlis is the national body. Its goal is to overcome genocide of Moscow power and ensuring the rights for national identity of Crimean Tatars. From 2014, when Verkhovna Rada issued a resolution where Mejlis and Kurultai were recognized to be higher representative bodies of Crimean Tatars, and Ukraine guarantees preservation of Crimean Tatars' culture and identity. The document also said, entrusted the Cabinet of Ministers to submit the documents to be adopted on the status of Crimean Tatars as indigenous people, commenting this document to governmental courier Herald. This is the main newspaper of the Verkhovna Rada of Ukraine. Well, this is good that Ukraine would like to declare Crimean Tatars indigenous people. Of course, Ukraine should have done that long ago. The same is saying Igor Semivalos, director of Center of Research on the Middle East. Crimean Tatars is not just population. This is a nation which has the rights for the land of Crimean Peninsula, and these rights, they are fixed in the international documents. Crimea is occupied, and for Crimean Tatars residing in the Crimea, this status gives nothing. In future, when the Crimea returns in legal terms to Ukraine, this status may start working, but indeed it should start to be done now. All fundamental documents should be compiled now. Commissioner to European Court of Human Rights, Boris Babin, is saying that starting with the independence of Ukraine 1996, Constitution of Ukraine is saying that Crimean Tatars have the same rights as Ukrainians. Now Crimean Tatars are recognized indigenous nation, and representatives of Crimean Tatars like Karaims and Krimchaks, small nations, they took part in development of the rights of indigenous people of Ukraine. After adoption of the Constitution of Ukraine the requirements set by the UN. The proposals were submitted by Crimean Tatars, Krimchaks and Karaims, but at the legislative level, Ukraine has not fixed the rights of Crimean Tatars and other indigenous people. Also, the Constitution declares this. Only on March 20, 2014, the Crimean Tatars were recognized indigenous people of Ukraine. Then Ukraine recognized the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People. It was the declaration was adopted in 2007. Article 3, indigenous people have the right for self-identification.
Article 5. Article 5, indigenous people have a right to keep and to reinforce their peculiar political, legal, economical, social and cultural institutions, keeping their right, if they want it, for the full participation in political, economical, social and cultural life of the country. Article 30. Military activities on the lands or territories of the indigenous people doesn't go except for the cases when there are the interests of the country or when there is a request from these indigenous people. Article 46, clause 1. Nothing in this declaration can be interpreted as the right of any country, population, group of the people, or individual to do some activities or to make some actions breaking the statute of the United Nations or that can be considered as sanctions or they can lead to the breaking of the integrity and political unity of the countries. Article 46, clause 3, provisions provided in these declarations are interpreted according to the principles of fairness, democracy, respect of the human right, equality, non-discrimination, good governance and self-consciousness. Experts say that there is one more document also interesting, and let's point attention to it now. It is a convention of International Labour Organization. It also says about the rights and freedoms of the indigenous people, and this document is legal binding. The recognition of Ukrainian government, Crimean Tatars as indigenous people is just the beginning of the way, because we still need to ratify the law. The law itself would help to keep saving the foundation of Ukrainian sovereignty, I mean Constitution of 1996, I mean Constitution of the Crimea of 1998, and it can't be changed at the moment due to the occupation. Laws of the government of Crimea, of other state bodies of Crimea, can renew the Crimean autonomy as keeping the ethnicity in the same way it was restored in 1991 by the law of Ukraine and according to the requirements of international law. The expert of Ukrainian Independent Center of Political Research, Yulia, Tyschenko, also insists on this law because it will solve as a range of issues connected to the coexistence of the country and political structure of Crimean Tatars, and will give civilized possibilities for communication, for influence spheres distribution, and involvement of Crimean Tatars to the decisions about their population. Talking about this period of Ukrainian history, all of us remember that in the Constitution 1996, for the three times they mention indigenous people in different combinations, and there were hot discussions in that time. talking about any regulations or even just the discussion of the topics about indigenous people. Why it wasn't ratified? Because those who take the decisions always had some limitation on the national level, on the Crimean level. There was some strange image about of Crimean Tatars, and to pronounce these decisions, the range of threats can exist, and that's why the decisions were blocked for more than 20 years. I'm talking about the Crimean Tatar separatism, stereotypes about talking may come. Also, Stalin heritage is still powerful. I mean deportation, I mean traitor issues. Very often in Moscow, in Kiev, these decisions couldn't be taken due to these scary rhetorics. I remember parliament hearing in 2002 when the representatives of the Communist parties publicly could give citations, and they were sure in these theses. And also key monopolist elites who took the decision, they always were looking to the reaction of Crimean political leaders. And it's not correct, but Slavic to say that, but it is. But they looked at the Slavic majority in Crimea, and they had their own views about Crimean Tatars. They called them traitors, separatists, so on and so forth. Also here there are some historical parallels, I mean relationship of Crimean Tatars and Russian Empire. They never been easy, and this deformed heritage influenced to the image of Crimean Tatars in Crimea, in Ukrainian society in whole. They always were scared of it, they didn't want it, and that's why the decision were blocked. Today the law about indigenous people is on the final stage of working out. I remember such law at the beginning of the independence of Ukraine, I mean the law about the status of Crimean people, and according to the conclusion of Expert Commission of Verkhovna Rada, they had no concept of national policy, and they told they didn't know what indigenous people were. And also they were asking why Crimean Tatars asks for separate status, because in this case all other populations of Ukraine would require the same. But after these new realities we are living in, unfortunately now, law draft was developed about the status of Crimean Tatars as indigenous people of Ukraine. And we would like it to pass expert commission or in OSCE. We wanted to pass Venice commission, not to have any contradictions. Then, of course, we can give the law to the Verkhovna Rada, but you can see yourselves what's going on there. Now there is practically no coalition. And I don't know in what way we're going to take this law. At the same time, the expert of Democracy Institute named by Philip Ovrik, Natalia, said extremely important are changes to the main document of Ukraine, where the status of Crimean Tatars will be fixed. As for me, constitutional provision of this issue is much more important. I mean the constitutional status of Crimean Tatars as indigenous people of Ukraine. Moreover, I can say that on the meetings of Constitutional Commission, the working group that was working on the Section 2, Human Rights, notwithstanding all efforts, any rights of indigenous people didn't include at all. All the section was devoted just to individual rights of the people. And now we have some time to think about thoroughly, deeply this issue and to propose as other part of the Constitution instead of section about autonomous Republic of Crimea. Of course, it's clear that this section should be reconsidered in full volume. There are no chances it can be made in the nearest future, but we can start deep professional expert legal work in this direction, and it's what is required now. And as all this time we were talking declaratively about our desire to integrate intensively, in this context, our lawmakers, the members of the Constitutional Commission, should get to know in what way the rights of the indigenous population Sami were fixed, not in some other regions, but in Europe, in three Scandinavian countries, that, as for me, are the best samples of the democracy. For today, Crimean Tatars, who were recognized by Ukrainian Parliament as indigenous people, and the number of experts say about strategic importance to create on the peninsula Crimean Tatar autonomy, but the reaction of the society was different. Let's try to find out, is there a need to define the status of Crimea and in what way it can influence to the future destiny of the peninsulas? Let's listen to the citizens on the street. What do you think, in what status we should return Crimea? It should be a region, it should be Autonomous Republic of Crimea, as it is now, or Crimean Tatar National Autonomy, Autonomous Republic of Crimea. Crimean Tatar Autonomous Formation, don't know which, it's hard to say now, but it should be part of Ukraine. I would like to have it as one of the regions of Ukraine. It would be better because Crimea is Ukraine. Crimean Tatar Autonomous Region or Republic. As they were deported in 1944, they suffered so much. Now we should help them to create good and comfortable life in Ukraine. I think Crimea should become a region, the same as other regions of Ukraine, because as for me, any autonomy can be the way for separatism. No matter will it be Russian separatism, Turkish separatism, or maybe some other separatism we didn't know about. Crimean Tatars have a right for their sovereignty. In the composition of Ukraine, it should be Crimean Tatar National Autonomy. Let it be anyway, but let it be Ukraine. As we can see, the views are different. The only thing that joins all the citizens is that Crimea is Ukrainian territory and it should be returned. And what about representatives of indigenous population and experts? Self-identification of Crimean Tatar population in the form of national autonomy. And all the rest is just a set of tools. And here, as for the head of Mejlis, it's very important to create the laws that will describe the coexistence of indigenous people with other nationalities in Crimea. We made the Constitution of the Republic of Crimea in the beginning of the 90s. We always were thinking about how we will coexist and co-manage of Crimea with other people, because it was a guarantee of our saving and our future. Let's start this work once again. As a Mejlis of Ukrainian Tatar population, we are ready We are ready together here at the peninsula for the moment of deoccupation to consider any initiatives, also the laws about other organizational forms, and we are ready to start executing these forms together with all other civil society and other structures interested in it. But the representatives of the Research Institute, Deputy Director of the Center of Statistical Research, has other opinion. As for me, of course, Sergei Danilov, as for me, of course, we should consider Crimean Tatar factor, but from functional, instrumental point of view, Crimean Tatar sovereignty is not possible just due to geographical reasons, because there are maximum 260,000 Tatars, and there are dozens of millions of people in Ukraine. Nobody can guarantee the stability in the situation when 15% of the population holds some symbolic power that will be in doubt from the point of view of the majority. But from other side, this or that form of realization of Crimean sovereignty is important. The question is which. But that is what we should discuss, because the issues of sovereignty of Crimean Tatar population in Crimea from one side is popularized, but from other side is standardized, because there is any materials where there is a vision. Plus, there are different sides of Crimean Tatar population. We don't have documents where there is a description of what are we talking about. In this aspect, there is nothing to discuss. But Ukrainian diplomat, the head of the organization Maidan abroad, thinks that now it's strategically important to define the status of Crimea. For me, first of all, this is the issue of the occupation of Crimea and Crimean Tatar questions. Tatars are going together. Without each other, they can't be solved. How does this connection work? We should solve the issue of status of Crimea before it will be returned. By the time our troops and our administration will come back to the territory of peninsula, we should have clear signals for Crimea, for other parts of Ukraine, what is the status of this region, what rights his citizens have. And it's very important to execute the rights of the Crimean Tatars from the aspect of UN conventions and other documents. But as for me, we should do it for sure. But also there are political reasons why we should do it, why we should solve this issue. After we return Crimea, we need to keep it. The problem with Crimea, with Crimean autonomy, was that de facto it became Russian autonomy in the territory of Ukraine. Now, when Russia thinks that Crimea belongs to Russia and Ukraine lost Crimea, they are trying. But now they are trying to make a kind of quasi-Crimea on the territory of occupied Donetsk and Lugansk regions. We need to keep Crimea, but not a Russian autonomy. And given it a status of Crimean Tatar national autonomy, that is answering two questions. First of all, this is the signal to the citizens of Crimea that their rights won't be decreased. They will believe in autonomy as they did before. They will have the same rights as other citizens of Ukraine. We are not going to punish them. Second, Crimean Tatar national autonomy is a guarantee that Crimea won't become Russian autonomy. And I belong to organization to the number of experts who insist absolutely that we need to return Crimea as Crimean Tatar autonomy. We need to explain to Ukrainian Russian speaking groups or populations how we are going to defend their rights. But Mustafa Dzhemilev says that it's not about the name, this is about the content of documents that will guarantee the rights of the indigenous people.
This autonomy is not mandatorily be named Crimean Tatars autonomy. Let it be a Crimean autonomous republic. The main thing is mechanisms of protection of indigenous people, their adequate representation, which will allow indigenous people to have their own opinion so that nobody can dictate their opinions to indigenous people. This is so, you know, European bodies, and I think this should not raise questions. There are several opinions on the future status of this peninsula. That is why this question is controversial. It is debated now. The unified opinion is that the indigenous people, they require support of government and people of Ukraine. Oliver Den is a president of Forum who said that European Parliament's position is very important. It was in the resolution of 2014 and the resolution on indigenous people will may be improved by adoption of other decisions by the European Parliament. As for me, when the European Parliament recognized Crimean Tatars as indigenous people, the status of indigenous people gives many individual and collective rights of the people. These rights are more extended. They are not individual rights like national minorities have. Indigenous people have more rights. And the international community recognized Crimean Tatars. The first step has been done. This is not the completion of the process. It would be useful if additional international institutional, more international institutions recognize Crimean Tatars as indigenous people, for example, the General Assembly of the United Nations. But the European Parliament also is important international institution, so international struggle between Russia and Ukraine in Crimean Tatar question, it is now at the new level. There's a different notions between Europe and Russia, and this strengthens political position of Crimean Tatars at international relations, in international relations, and according to Miroslav Marinovich, a dissident in Ukrainian society, the changes also took place in Crimean Tatar question. After the annexation of Crimea, I issued an article where I articulated an opinion that we should struggle for returning the Crimea to Ukraine. But only for the one purpose to give it to Crimean Tatars. All those doubts in 1990s whether to give it to Crimean Tatars or not, because there are other nationalities living in Crimea, how Crimean Tatars will be capable to harmonize the situation there. As for me, I had been visiting Crimea those years. I saw that they are the only people who can be real masters of those lands, because they are their native lands, and treatment to native land and to alien land have always differed in any place.
Moral da da li, Наших експертів до столу.
Invite our experts to take their seats at the round table.
В нас час до 17:20, правильно?
We will be working till 5:20. Good evening once again. Our panel discussion concerns the topic Crimea, protection of Crimea Tatars' rights, return of the peninsula. In this documentary, the keywords for me were in the final song of Crimean Tatar people. Every stone in Crimea is a part of my heart. This means that status for which Crimean Tatars had been struggling all those years when they returned from deportation. Indigenous people, this is a status which protects Crimean Tatars who are now under the pressure of occupational power. And this status will allow to return the Crimea to Ukraine if Ukraine will be capable to use this status and its practical implementation will be in place, the laws will be developed which will explain what does it mean in practice, the status of indigenous people. This is a chance to return Crimea because the only people who can decide on the political fate of the Crimea are Crimean Tatars. Article 46 on the resolution on indigenous people, it says that no militaries can be present at the land of indigenous people without their consent. And Crimean Tatars, of course, were again the occupational militaries. And of course, if we raise this discourse, it would be important. And the last message which I would like to articulate, the status, it opposes the myth. Indigenous people, some people think that this is a potential attempt to become separatists or to establish Tatar states. Very important now to agree what is this, what does this status means. Indigenous people, they are just people who were created in the territory of some country, some state. But Ukrainians themselves and Crimean Tatars, they should agree on the status, on its definition. So this is one of attempt which started in 2014 when first Crimean Tatars were recognized indigenous people. I would like to give the floor to a popular expert, Natalia Belitser, an expert. Thank you to all present here and the authors of the documentary and who helped to organize this event. I hope that this documentary and the discussion will be an important basis for further discussion and finding out how not to grant the status formally, but to implement the measures which will result in practical implications, how Crimean Tatars can use this status, why this is important both for Crimean Tatars and the state of Ukraine, the Ukrainian society, and the prospects of returning Crimea. And let's look at the recent developments, why it is so important to extend the status of indigenous people, protection of rights, and the Crimea, the territory belonging to indigenous people. The ban on Mejlis is known to everyone. All people and organizations at the national and international level responded to this event, but the reactions differ. The Council of Europe, unfortunately, it does not like to take care of any collective rights. The Council of Europe, like in its previous resolutions, accented the violation of rights as a national minority, one of minorities, and this is a very big difference. The ban on Mejlis as an extremist institution, according to the Russian legislation, where dozens or hundreds bans on organizations as extremist ones. Well, one more organization has been banned in the long list of violations of the of civil rights. Indeed, it was an unprecedented event which could be of the same importance and the annexation of Crimea. The ban concerns that not some NGO, but an executive electoral body of self-governments of the whole people, whole nation. This is an unprecedented event. Just imagine the other aspect. Sometime in 1939-1940, Russia occupied one-seventh of Finland, annexed it, and those territories remained under Soviet reign. Of course, Russia would like to occupy the northern part of Finland, so it declared the parliament of Sami parliament an extremist organization and banned it, and so on. It was an absolute unprecedented event in this context, in this from this perspective, we should concentrate our efforts on the national level, lobbying and pressing our lawmakers not only to complete and adopt the law on indigenous people, but a very important, and it was mentioned in the documentary, to ratify Convention Number 179 ensuring absolutely other level of compliance with indigenous people rights as a legally binding document. And I would like to ask all journalists present here and NGO activists and civil rights advocates who have contacts with many counterparts abroad and in the country, please highlight and cover this aspect, because sometimes in Europe individual rights are in question, and we are talking about collective rights. And after this documentary, we can imagine how important the difference and how the positions of Ukraine are strengthened now that now Ukrainian advocacy organizations and diplomatic services are doing this. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Natalia. And now I give the floor to Eskender Aliyev, representative of the Mejlis of the Crimean Tatar people, the institution that has the position on this issue, that who should answer the question, what is Crimean Tatar autonomy, who should develop the vision of this autonomy as it is, and to present it to the Ukrainian society. Eskender, the floor is yours. Good day, dear participants of our round table. As we started our meeting from the movie, I would like to express my gratitude to the leader of the project, Eldar, to all the editing staff, because we could see how professional the journalists who participated in this movie. Because in Ukrainian society during these 23 years, Crimean Tatars asked few times for the restoration of their political rights. Why I'm talking about political rights? Because the rights can be of different forms. But not just establishment of Ukraine didn't hear Ukrainian Tatars, but also Ukrainian society doesn't really know what Ukrainian Tatars want, what political rights are they talking about, and what is their aim. And also in this movie, we forgot about one more indigenous people. There are Uruns. Uruns is a Christian population. They are very close to Tatars. They were formed in Crimea. They were deported by Russian Empire 200 years ago. Of course, they told them, dissenters now, that they were trying to save them from Muslims, but they just brought us, the Christian population, to the Crimea, that were not in the Crimea from the very beginning. And about perspectives of solution of the issue of the rights of Crimean Tatar population from one side, it's reality from us. It says there are some historical aspects. I think for Ukraine, especially taking into consideration that Ukraine goes to European Union, Ukraine selected European values, Ukraine tries to be legal country. And here there are few aims. First aim is historical, the restoration of historical fairness, because Crimean Tatars, they were not just formed on the Ukrainian territory, but they had their own state. Second, there are moral values. Third, democratic values, because we should think that these people, indigenous people of Crimea, they have no other motherland, they have no other country. And fourth is strategical, because more and more often we hear, especially on the high level, that it's not possible to return to Crimea without Crimean Tatars, and that's true. And what is happening now to Crimean Tatar population is – And the last building Ukrainian flag was removed was the building of Crimean Tatar Mejlis. And they ask not just Crimean Tatars, but all pro-Ukrainian population of Crimea not to go to referendum. And 90% of the Crimean Tatars didn't go to this referendum. They showed their position, and that's what exactly occupant doesn't like. And Mejlis of Crimean Tatar population, they ask not to participate in the election of the local elections. And also, Mejlis of Crimean Tatar population has more rights to prohibit the actions of the occupant powers of Crimea, occupational court that took this decision, that occupational power itself. And also, Mejlis of Crimean Tatar population, according to the law of Verkhovna Rada from 20th of March, is the official body representative Crimean Tatar population. And up till now, that's what occupant powers don't like. Until now, till the taking of this decision by court, the activities of Mejlis on the territory of occupied territories was continuing. It is the part of the power that happened on the occupied territory. Also, when we are talking about legal process, I personally never believed, and I thought they took the decision by administrative way. They put it into register with the help of the Ministry of Justice of Russian Federation to limit the actions of Crimean Tatar population. But at the same time, we could see they went into court decision as well. We think we will continue in the legal field, and we know and we will win because the truth is ours, and in political field as well. And also the court that prohibited this way, and just few experts told about them. Venice Commission in its time made a conclusion. It was critics. Venice Commission told that the definition extremist materials is not clear, and it can lead to unproportional extremist measures. So in Venice Commission told already that this law is against and doesn't correspond to European Convention for Human Rights, and in this aspect, in that time, Venice Commission proposed their help to Russia to regulate this issue. But as we see, Russian Federation had the aim to go in this way. As you remember, the law was taken some time ago in Russian Federation that they can use their military forces to protect Russian speaking population. As we can see, all this process had its aim, and it was focused on the occupation of new territories. But all of us witness, and we don't just witness. All of us in the world, we are responsible for that, because we see as aggressor countries, that is the subject of international organization who signed a lot of international treaties, now keeps on genociding the population. Because to prohibit Crimean Tatars, it is to prohibit the whole population. We experienced the same in the Soviet Union, because in the list of populations of Soviet Union there was no box Crimean Tatars, but we were fighting for this. We could return to our motherland. We keep on fighting for our political rights, and today there is no Soviet Union, but there is Crimean Tatar movement. And I think that with the time, the world will understand its responsibility for Crimean Tatar population, because now it's not just responsibility of the Ukraine, but the international responsibility. And now task is to join our efforts now to press on aggressing country, to provide at least at the initial stage the rights and freedom, and to protect physically Crimean Tatars who didn't agree the aggression, didn't agree the breaking of the rules of international law that Russian Federation is doing now. I think that I can add something else during our discussion, and I hope we can elaborate further ways, further solutions all together. And now we are waiting for the way, for the ways how to give this information more to international society. Today, information from the aspect of information, attitude to Crimean Tatars has been changed. But now the paradigm is the following: the enemy of my enemy is my friend. This is the attitude to Crimean Tatars, but after the occupation of Crimea, and a lot of experts say this, the moods of Ukrainian society can be changed, because a lot of people mix the right of the indigenous people for self-identification with separatism, and that's exactly what Eskender told. We need to explain to Ukrainian society it's not separatism. We need to explain to Ukrainian society what is it, but Mejlis itself should present its own formula, was it its autonomy, and I hope this discussion is started already, and I want to give the floor to Andriy Didenko. No? Okay, let's give the floor to Ms. Yulia Tyschenko. She's an expert of the Ukrainian Center for Independent Political Research. Thank you. Thank you very much, Ukraine Crisis Media Center, for the possibility to show this movie. The movie let us start the discussion. As for me, it doesn't give the answer to all the questions, but it gives the questions and let us possibility to think about them. At least when we're talking about the future of Crimea, about the future autonomy, about our vision of this autonomy. For me, a lot of things in the movie are obvious from the 90s. It's very complicated to talk about the same things for so many years. It also the issue of recognition of Crimean Tatars as indigenous people. It was made, by the way, they were recognized. And the decision was taken on 20th of March of 2014 by Verkhovna Rada. There was a declaration that you saw in the movie. What can it give us? First of all, it's a very logical step, and it would be very nice if the law drafts, different versions of it, were put by parliament and considered and ratified. I think it's not just technical solution, but and even that we are sitting here today, it's a kind of learning process as well. All the stages should be passed. And regarding the future autonomy, somebody thinks that Crimea will never be back. Some people think that the occupation of Crimea will become real. No, there is no Freud issue in this context, at least. If it will happen, it won't change anything. We will still have the status of the autonomy with all the consequences. I think But you can discuss it with me, of course. I'm open for the conversations. The integral part of the occupation of Crimea is formation of definite scenario models, the change of autonomy. I would like it to have Crimean Tatar autonomy as a part of Ukraine. But talking about the occupation in aspect of indigenous people, if you read attentively about the rights of indigenous people, there are clear definitions. The identification of the status, different issues connected to ecology, to demilitarization of this territory, they can't be solved without taking into consideration, and that is one of the key aspects of the opinion of indigenous people themselves, who were formed and who live on these territories. As for me, the inclusion of this thing is not logical into the process connected to the occupation. Of course, if these talks will start sooner or later, and we started January with declarations from the head of the state that 2016 will be the year of the occupation of Donetsk, and Lugansk regions, that this military conflict will be solved, and also it will be 2016 will become the year of the occupation of the Crimea. For me, there is a number of steps that should be made by Ukraine. Ukraine also should define their position strategically. Really, it is the development of the status of indigenous people. There is a social information discussion of these things to explain people all possible advantages and disadvantages of this process. And really, it is a discussion about reflection of definite things in the Constitution of Ukraine. There is a section in the Constitution of Ukraine, Autonomous Republic of Crimea. Moreover, the relevant of fears, discussions, and Crimean society in Kyiv is not generous. Donetsk Crimean society in Kyiv is also not generous. But the principles, the basis, and I also mean the rights of the national ethnical groups. Consensus should be found between the different subjects of this process. It's normal. There is nothing extraordinary about it. Maybe these things might frighten. And it might involve the issues of the education, language, some other issues. They don't threaten anybody. Really, it is an open field for the discussions. But as for me, we need to implement it, having more clear vision and aim what it's gonna be.
Yes. Crimean Tatar autonomy is not a threat to the rights of other ethnical groups residing in Crimea, and it will remain a part of Ukraine because this is a declaration of UN which provides such rights for self-determination, which should not violate national laws of Ukraine, for example, or some other country. I would like to comment the figures. Maidanov International Affairs represented sources survey. 45.5% of Ukraine think that the Crimea will not return to Ukraine, and 48% of Ukraine are saying that it will return to Ukraine. Out of them, 7% think that within nearest years it will be returned. An interesting information that the most optimistic persons live in villages, and the majority of pessimists live in cities. And I would like to give the floor to Les Shevchenko. He is a dissident and human rights activist. I joined the process of Crimean Tatar combating for their rights. When I returned from Moscow, I stayed at Larissa Bagara's apartment. She is from Kharkiv. She is a lawyer and the civil rights advocate. She is known from the times of protest in Moscow against occupation of Czech Republic by Russian tanks, and he's met me with the words, here is a collective letter against occupation of Crimea. In previous years, such collective letters were the reasons for in jailing people in KGB cellars, but I was happy and I was glad to sign that collective letter in protection of Crimean Tatars people, because Crimean Tatars were picketing for their rights in the street just those days. In 1 year, Ukraine established Ukrainian Helsinki Association. This was the first civil rights NGO in the Soviet Union. Vyacheslav Chernobyl was its main and key enthusiast and idea promoters. We had a political program declaration of principles of UGS. This was a political program of combating, of opposing the Soviet regime. One of the provisions of our political program was to give Crimean Tatars, Crimean Tatar national territorial autonomy. That provision we defended during our activities. And now, in the scope of our activities with Ukrainian Helsinki Association and when 12 leaders of Ukrainian Helsinki Association were elected to the Verkhovna Rada of Ukraine, along with the Ruch movement, we prepared a declaration of rights. We were preparing the main draft document to be voted by the Verkhovna Rada about the it was the declaration of state sovereignty of Ukraine, and the main ideas, main provisions of Ukrainian Helsinki Association, they were included in the declaration, and in our debates in the Verkhovna Rada, they are now committees. In those commissions, we continued to protect and to promote our principles, including giving Tatars national territorial autonomy. And I remember those debates. I had personally discussions with the head of Communist Crimea, Mr. Bagrov, but in the Verkhovna Rada, the majority was from Communist Party, 239 persons. It was the Communist majority headed by Oleksandr Maroz. They didn't allow us to adopt the law about the Crimea which we proposed. So that is why the Crimean autonomy was in that shape, in that form, which Mr. Bagrov from Communist Party wanted, but not the one which we proposed. Mustafa Jamilev invited me then when I came to his 60th anniversary. There was a big assembly in Simferopol in the Central Drama Theater. Yushchenko and the Ministry of Interior and all the leaders of Crimea, they were invited and present, and I greeted Mr. Jamilev. And I appealed to all the audience, and I said that I wished as soon as possible to give Crimean Tatar national autonomy. I was the only person from Kiev who declared that, and my speech was met with enthusiasm. So the Turkish ambassador sat beside me. He paid attention to my speech. He said that Les Shevchenko was more welcomed in this among this audience than even the president of the country, Yushchenko. And Yushchenko said that Les Shevchenko said what people wanted to hear. In 1990s, both in the parliament and in other political circles of Ukraine, in political community of Ukraine, the opinion that if autonomy is granted to Crimean Tatars, this may result in that they will become separatists and they will demand separation. There are no reasons now to proceed with those talks that they will become separatism. Now we have all grounds to receive the deoccupied Crimea. I'm sure it would happen within the forthcoming years, very soon, and we should receive it back as a national Crimean Tatar autonomy. And now I'm giving the floor to Oleksiy Mayorov. This is the final speech for this panel. Thank you for giving me the floor as a representative of a body which popularize memory of the nation. I would like to cover treatment of Crimean Tatar people so that Ukrainians not base their attitudes only on one means that an enemy of my enemy is my friend. So we should depart from such combinations. And for this, Ukrainians should know more of Crimean Tatar history, because such knowledge is very medium. Ukrainians lack a knowledge of Crimean Tatar history. What should be appealed to when we are talking that Crimean Tatars are indigenous people of Crimea? What is the main idea? What is the main sense of this notion? How can we explain it to Ukrainians? The status of indigenous people, this is not a privilege merely. Indigenous people are those people created at a certain territory. Now we are talking about the Crimean Peninsula. They do not have another motherland, another state outside the borders of Crimea, where they can preserve themselves, so they are concentrated in Crimea, and only from with this territory their fate is linked. Otherwise, Crimean Tatars will not have the territory for their self-actualization, so they will extinct from the face of the earth. So ethnical diversity of our planet, it should be preserved, and it will undergo the loss of the whole nation without such mechanism as representative national bodies. Understanding this, we can use parallels with Ukrainian history. Our struggle for national identity, for our preservation as a nation, we know this very well. We had been struggling for actualization, for implementation of our rights against Russian Empire and other invaders, and Crimean Tatar Khanat in 70s of 18th century, Crimean nationhood was as well as Cossack state and the Ukrainian identity. Both of them were annihilated due to invasion of Russian Empire. So Tatars of Crimea, they were known from ancient time. Russian Empire objected Ukrainians and Crimean Tatars' nationhood, and Turkish separatism, which was mentioned in the documentary, this is very well known for Ukrainians, because Ukrainian nationhood also was blamed artificial by Russian Federation, that Ukrainians are a Polish idea or Austrian idea. So Ukrainian society, from our own history, should understood what is happening, and how the Crimean Tatars' history of their nationhood is perverted by propaganda, and the project supported by the National Memory Institute, as concerns Crimea, we can tell you some time about those projects.
And let's finish with the discussion. The giving of the status, it is a test for Ukraine, for Ukrainian society, for democracy. This is democratic practice for our country and for our society. And now we are starting second panel. Miss Natalia will moderate it. Those who wants to hear, please stay. And those who couldn't give their comments, you can do it on second panel as well. Thank you very much, Miss Emine. Dear participants, dear guests, we have 2 minutes. Two minutes to start second panel. You can take your seats or change your position. Thank you.
Шановні колеги,
dear colleagues, let's start the second part of our panel. I would like to remind you that the second part of our panel is the algorithm of return of Crimea Peninsula, problems of deoccupation and reintegration. I would like to thank Emine that she was moderating the first part so professionally. I hope the second part will be the same interesting. And I was listening to the first part of the discussion and thought that there is an opinion that every person has his own map. I mean that the perception of the world depends on your nature. But listening to you gambling with the facts, I believe your expert opinion. I understand that this axiom that the Crimea and Crimea Tatars are equal to each other. Crimea is Ukraine, it's an autonomous republic, but watching this movie, not all the people understand it, not all the people know about it. There is a lack of information. And we, as Ukraine Crisis Media Center, initiate the creation of public field to help the Ministry of Information Policy to consolidate the actions of the country and civil society in the direction of joint work to return Crimean Peninsula. I understand that this is ambitious initiative, but it's good and it should be. Also, we have initiative to make the project of spokesperson on Crimean issues on constantly. We propose the Ministry of Occupied Territories, Vadym Chernysh, to become the spokesperson of the peaceful life, and we are very glad that on our today's meeting there is Kovalenko Tatiana Petrina, who is assistant to Mr. Chernysh and who is here with us. And all the things we will talk about today, she will transfer them to Vadym Chernysh as resolutions that will be prepared by our secretary with the help of the stream for this meeting. And now I give the floor to Oleksiy Starodubov, who prepared for today his own vision of the strategy, how we should return Crimea. And after him, I invite everybody for discussion. Oleksiy, the floor is yours. Good afternoon, dear colleagues. Thank you very much, Ukraine Crisis Media Center, for inviting us and for such a possibility. It's a very good, very, very correct initiative. And really, we need to discuss the problem of Crimea widely and to make it more visible. I would like to congratulate everybody that we have profiled ministry for this problem, because Cabinet of Ministers of Ukraine will deal with this problem. And preparing to this round table, I would like to say that starting from 2014, it didn't change a lot, and those clauses that were discussed after elections are still actual. The goal is the same. The goal of the strategy is the occupation of the peninsula, the return of Crimea into Ukraine, and the joining of Crimea, maybe in the status of Crimean Tatar autonomy, but anyway, Crimea should be back to Ukraine. The first stage of the strategy for me is the complex of economical and legal actions that don't allow territories to be developed according to the screenplay of aggressing country. What is declared by Russian Federation is the development of territory of Crimea should be blocked from our side, and to get some different messages and blocks on this development. And the second stage foresees the return to Ukraine with logical conclusion of these events foreseen by the first stage. Regarding the strategy and conditional blocks on reintegration, the strategy can be divided per three blocks: civil, constitutional, and international. Civil block should include the activities for the protection of fundamental rights and freedoms. The citizens of Ukraine and Crimean people should be restored in the fundamental rights foreseen by the Constitution of Ukraine. I'm talking about the right to vote and to be voted, for education, freedom of religion, freedom of movement, so on and so forth. Also, there are freedoms connected to other rights. First of all, I'm talking about dual taxation, the right for the pension. Crimeans who live on the territory of occupied Crimea should not suffer. It happened historically. Those who have Ukrainian passport should be provided in the same way as the citizens living in other parts of Ukraine. And third clause about civil block is also important. It is a protection of IDPs from Crimea here on this territory. I'm talking about the provision of living conditions, the protection of their bank deposits, the confirmation of their rights for the land and property. There is a whole complex of problems that should be solved here with the direct participation of the profiled ministry. Constitutional block includes changes into the constitution of Ukraine because of the occupation of Autonomous Republic of Crimea. And also here we can reflect the limitations connected to fundamental rights foreseen by the Constitution. Here we can define the politics of Ukraine about the occupation, what will be the next stage, and when we see Crimea as a part of Ukraine. All these can be reflected in the transition provisions, because we understand it is a temporary condition and Crimea is temporary occupied territory. Sooner or later, it will return to Ukraine and will be autonomous republic in the part of Ukraine. And here also prohibition to have local referendum, that imperative norm that would allow to prohibit the export of these unclear local referendums that we experienced for the first time in Crimea. And these changes allow also to fix our position as a country, how to treat this local referendum, and to spoil aggressors this idea that every society has a right for self-identification. And here we come to the international bloc that foresees active actions connected to the reintegration of Crimea. There are great arguments to change the constitution of Ukraine and to provide the international legal provisions to restore the international law on the territory of Crimea. And also in the international bloc, it foresees, first of all, the claim to Russian Federation regarding the breach of our integrity and illegal annexation in 2014. Also, we can include here, and we should include here, the protection of rights of Ukrainian economic subject whose rights were broken during the annexation. I mean the illegal nationalization of the enterprises, taking of property from the businessmen who didn't want to re-register, according to some unclear Russian laws connected to the occupied territory. Also, it is a help with the claims to international commercial arbitral courts about loss of property through international courts. Those events that would allow us to define clearly our position as a country, what we do with those suffered from this illegal annexation. The foundation for all these events should be the claim to the International UN Court, and I will come back to this issue later. And one of the key issues is the constant work with our European American partners on sanctions provision. It should be planned regular working order. Every every designation in Crimea should be followed followed by the list. Every cooperation with investors should be reflected in the list. This list shall be sent to our European and American partners every day, and they shall be filled in every day. We should take this managerial fundament from the Commission of Powers of Crimea. Even now, nobody wants to go there. Nobody from federal official persons, because they think it's a black hole. So let's have clear understanding. If Russian officials go to the position of Crimea or they work as a nationalized enterprise, they will work only with occupational powers. Regarding international bloc, one of the key messages here is that if today we are leaving the territory of Ukraine, just some of our partners understand what scenario of the occupation of Crimea we have. Everybody starts asking questions from the experts, from the lawmakers. Is it military, political? How are we going to solve the problem of Crimean crisis? If you're talking about Donbas, everything is clear. There are Minsk agreements. At least there is some format. But about Crimea, nobody knows. That's what we have for today. This is our reality. And the claim to the International UN Court will fix our status on Crimean problem. It will fix the positions. Our state policy is based on the occupation. We will define clearly what rights were broken in 2014. Our rights as a state, and we understand where we go and what scenario did we choose. Of course, we understand that we don't even discuss military scenario. We have only political diplomatic scenario. We should move on it, and we should use the possibilities to the full. About international bloc and preparation for the claims to international UN court. There are a few important theses. Taking into consideration the Russia for today is has the full rights of Soviet Union. Let's look at the
There is opportunity to file a lawsuit in the construct of international treaties to which the Russian Federation is a party. This is the struggle against terrorism. According to this convention, they can be punished according to its articles of this convention on combating terrorism. And even Russian Federation's legislation, terrorism provisions, they also contain such provisions on the threat to citizens of other state. We have such opportunity, and we should use it, I think, in the framework of settlement of disputes under this convention. We should file a lawsuit as soon as we sue Russia in the international court. We can appeal to the norms of ordinary law. International lawyers will understand me. There are such rights which are not subject to proving in court, so we can use these rights recognized by the international community and Russia, and they can be used in the proceedings and the item concerning breaking our borders and intervention with our freedoms. So filing a lawsuit, we fix our status quo and we declare a message for those businessmen and citizens whose rights were violated. They would have the opportunity to claim against Russian Federation, but not against Ukraine. Then businessmen and citizens will understand the state of Ukraine. When those businessmen and citizens understand that Ukraine doesn't care about their problems and doesn't protect them and take no steps to protect their ownership right, then they will sue Ukraine. So the way out is the only one in order to evade claims against Ukraine. We should file a claim with the UN International Court and in these proceedings to move forward to protect the rights of Ukraine and its citizens. And I am sure we will win, and then we will have a legal tool to deoccupy and to reintegrate Crimea. Of course, Russian Federation may not recognize this decision, then she would 100% oppose the whole international community because such precedents have never existed in the world history. I propose such a scenario, and we can discuss my proposal at this panel, and I will file this proposal with the profile ministry. I would like to remind you that we are talking about the tools, how the expert panel thinks, how we can return Crimea to Ukraine. Please join our debates and propose your options. Our secretary, who watch us online, he is now compiling minutes, and and tomorrow we will submit our proposals to the ministry. I would like to thank Mr. Starodubov for conceptual approach. This is not yet a strategy. We can't name his speech a strategy. About strategies, many activists have been talking from Crimea because occupation of Crimea took place before the occupation of Donetsk and Lugansk regions. And as concerns the vision, there was such a Maidan of International Affairs organization, and various NGOs of among students of universities, and also the Council of Security of Ukraine. It also has developed some proposals how to deoccupy Crimea, and how the minister becomes a member of the cabinet. Then we can talk more about the occupation of Crimea. In 2014, when Donbass had not been occupied those days, we initiated that we need a central executive authority, a ministry on Crimea, in parentheses, occupied territories. We talked that the strategy should be articulated by the central executive body competent in these matters. And those days we told that the law is required on the rights and freedoms on the territory, on occupied territories. Those days they were Crimea and Sebastopol. There were IDP problems those days already, and when we formed the structure and when we compiled a regulation, we thought that the laws should be implemented somehow. For this, a central executive authority was needed, which should pass regulatory documents to implement the law in practice. That is why we decided there should be several departments established, one for IDPs, one for occupied territories, and the third for ensuring the rights, social, legal rights of deported citizens by national attribute. And here we saw each area. As I have already said, there are laws, but they do not work. So that they work, we need subordinate legislation, secondary legislation. This is a separate topic. Mr. Starodubov already mentioned it. I don't know why he mentioned the topic of national referendum. These are different topics, and they should be considered as separate blocks. Today we should consider that replacement of population takes place in Crimea now, because this is a military crime according to the Convention of 1939, and we should develop mechanisms. When today we should think how to restore or establish bodies, authorities of the Crimea, so-called local councils. There were elections. We could brought thousands of Crimean citizens to Ukrainian territory so that they vote. And then they can restore the rights and restore the status of the Republic of Crimea, as it was said by Natalia Bielitz. And I know she is a supporter of one of the concepts that during the constitutional reform of Ukraine, the status of the Autonomous Republic of Crimea should be defined clearly. And the constitution of the Autonomous Republic of Crimea could be changed only by the representative bodies of the Republic of Crimea. And the third way is seems most realistic. This is adoption of the law about indigenous people, which will be able to contribute to the constitution of the Autonomous Republic of Crimea in the part of rights of indigenous people. This discussion, it can't cover all the matters within one discussion, but we are ready for debates. We are ready to join with other organizations and to engage experts. In the Russian Federation, the Ministry for Crimea has been already liquidated, but in our country it has not yet been established. It is at the stage of establishing. In Ukrainian establishment and power, there is one problem. experts and think tanks are not engaged in development of legislative and regulatory framework in Ukraine. This is a problem. We should combine our efforts and put all our efforts into the occupation of Crimea and Donbas region and Lugansk region. I'm giving the floor to Tamila Tasheva.
Good afternoon, dear colleagues. Thank you very much to everybody for your participation. It's really very important. And I wanted to say in the preliminary panel as well. But unfortunately, we are limited in time. This topic is very close to me because from the very beginning of the occupation of Crimea by Russian Federation, we started dealing with IDPs, with advocacy issues of Crimean's international arena. It's very important to do it now. We really glad that now we have this new ministry responsible for occupied territories and IDPs. I'm sure it is achievement of the civil society because they were lobbying this issue actively. Really, it's very important to talk about the strategy on the occupation of Crimea. I agree that Mr. Starodubov, who presented his vision, that is not complete, and Eskender told that civil society, together with the Security Council of Ukraine, made sessions where they worked out the directions we need to do. Of course, it should be international direction. It should be working in informational area. It should be working with us, with staff. As for me, it's a problem of us, of the state bodies, because we don't work enough with people who live in the occupied territories. First of all, I mean children. And I want in new legislation to have education for the kids from occupied territory. I want them to have possibility to transfer here. And of course, it's very important to talk about the courts. I'm not talking only about UN courts. There should be international tribunals. It should be European Court of Human Rights. All the international institutions should be involved because only by the way of international pressure and based on legal norms, we can push this issue. We should continue working with IDPs from Crimea and to have separate strategy on working with these people. I'm not talking about this one million and a half IDPs from the east of Ukraine because Crimean IDPs have their own specifics, and the way we are going to help these people will reflect on the reintegration of Crimea after the occupation. And I don't discuss the status of Crimea because it should be in the composition of Ukrainian state. As for us, it should be national territorial autonomy. And only through this tool we can solve the issue of Crimea return only in this way, because Crimean Tatars play a huge role in this process and will do it in the future. I think that's very important and are the documents about the births and the deaths. There should be cooperation with the Ministry of Justice. Really, there is a huge number of issues. Iskander talked about it already. We won't solve all that just in 5 minutes, and we have just 15-20 minutes for our discussion, but it's very important that we started the discussion in public field, not just an expert group, because it's very important to bring the messages that this work is going on. Ukrainian citizens should know about that, not to have the situation when Maidan abroad published the results that 40% don't believe the Crimea will be returned. Of course, it's connected to the absence of actions from state bodies during 2 years, because the citizens were trying to replace the state working with IDPs, working with occupation. There were some movements of the state authorities. But and we are very glad that we have ministry now. We are always open. We help even now. Some other NGOs only help to this new ministry. Mr. Vadym Chernysh is one of the first actions. Is he met civil society organization and he told that Crimea wasn't his main issue, and he asked for help. And I think it would be very important to designate somebody who would represent Mejlis or Crimean Tatars, or just to have official from this environment who is dealing with Crimean Tatar issues every day. But of course, we need to structure the work of the ministry on the directions of the occupied territories. And also, there would be nice to have a hub coordinating the work of different departments. First of all, it is the work of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Ministry of Information Policy, constant involvement of other ministries, because this Ministry of Occupied Territories is profiled for this issue. That's why thank you very much for this possibility to share my thoughts with you. Thank you very much, Tamila. Unfortunately, just 10 minutes left. That's why I propose to optimize this time. I know Mr. Andriy Didenko wanted to tell us something, and after that we will give floor to Tatiana Kovalyova, who is a representative of this new ministry we talked so much about today. Andriy Didenko, the floor is yours. You have 2 minutes. Thank you very much for the participation in Ukraine Crisis Media Center to prepare this event, because during 2 days we made a lot of steps to prepare it. And Ukraine Crisis Media Center agreed to hold this event from the very beginning, because people understand the actuality of this topic. And the second issue, I'm disappointed because there are human rights specialists in the hall. But first of all, we wanted them to be involved. But still, they look the stream. I hope this issue will be interesting for them. And in biggest part, we were talking about the movie we saw in the first part. In the context of discussion of this movie, there are questions from our dear expert. It's very hard for me to add something. The only thing I can constant as a representative of Kharkiv human rights protection groups, for these two years, the human rights of people in Crimea is broken in Crimea. They make them. There are tortures. There are punishment. for activists, for journalists, and Kharkiv Advocacy Group, Helsinki Advocacy, gives help to IDPs and to people who are in prisons, who have no possibility to execute their rights themselves. And I hope by common efforts we will find algorithm to protect the human rights in Crimea. And of course, we should remember about the occupation and return of Crimea to Ukraine. Thank you. And now I give the floor to the assistant of the minister. The floor is yours. Thank you very much. First of all, I'm very thankful that ministry was invited to this event because it's very useful. Really, there are informational gap on Crimean issues, and not everybody understands what Mejlis was doing this time, what will be the future of the Crimea. That's why we need to discuss these questions. We need to discuss them now. And there is a useful movie about it. Some issues are new for me. Before, I was working in the state agency for Donbass restoration on 20th of April 2016. There was an order to create Ministry for Occupied Territories, and it was made by merging of state agency of Donbass restoration issues and state office on Crimean issues. That's why the ministry will deal with Crimean issues as well. And as I told Tamila already, we are open for cooperation on these issues. As an agency, we created a concept to restore and rebuild the peace in the East, and now with your help, we have the strategy to return the Crimea, and we need to continue this work, and we invite you to join to the ministry. And in the future, the ministry will become a kind of platform for discussion of all this issue, and the status of the ministry will help to solve bureaucratic issues. That's also very important. Thank you. And now Emine have 1 minute. Thank you very much, Miss Natalia. You told about information gaps. The only thing I'm worried about is that algorithm is different. I think information now should work for the common political vision. The gap is that now in the country, we as civil society and government, we didn't agree what is the Crimea, how we're going to return it, what is the status of this territory. And now I just want to tell you some thesis on which I built my job. I understand that by information we won't return the Crimea when we have the military forces of other country on the territory of Crimea. Of course, we can work with the minds of the people, but we can't return the territory only by the talks. Today, more than 40% of Ukrainians forgot about Crimea, and for them, Crimea is a closed story. They are ready to give the Crimea, and they say that Ukraine can exist without Crimea. That's why for them, we are building few communication campaigns. And that is one of the achievements of the ministry, that you have the word resistance in the information environment. And we did it because to broke this myth that there are separatists in Crimea, and I hope we will finish this job by having this day, 26th of February, as Resistance Day, and for us it will be it will be the day where every year we can remind the Ukrainians about this day and to build our information campaigns based on this day. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Emine. Mr. Valjar, you are welcome. Thank you for giving me the floor, the opportunity. I don't have a strategy on the occupation of Crimea. I have a proposal that could significantly make this event close, the event of the occupation. And it may transfer a message to Crimean people that Crimea is Ukraine. Why Crimean people should go to Kiev or Kherson to get services at the border crossing and passing point, services should be provided. This will simplify the procedure. Why our humanitarian institutes are not open in Kherson region? Why it is open in Kiev? Why affiliate is not established in Kherson region? This would simplify logistics for students and parents. Parents will better understand where a son or a daughter resides from Monday to Friday. The student studies in Kherson, then passes the border and comes home for a weekend. Just imagine residents of Crimea now are deprived of mobility, of freedom of movement. I can't leave Crimea using my own car to when I move to Ukraine. I am banned to do so. So we should not make residents of Crimea to vote in Kherson or to study in Kharkiv or Kiev. We, as civil society activists, we should make our borders closer to Crimea. When we are here in Kiev, are saying that Crimea is Ukraine. Let's think what we are doing in this direction. Let's open service hubs at the border crossing points. It seems to me very important to articulate to give a definition of collaborationism. Legislature does not articulate definition, doesn't adopt any definition of a collaborationism. Any person can be blamed of being a collaborationist. You, as a minister, you should initiate the works on developing a definition who is deemed a collaborationist. It is very important to abandon such rhetorics as non-residents. Are we citizens of Ukraine or not? Do we have the right for our own savings in private bank or other bank? And as an alternative, in terms of as a classical activist of civil society, I would like to address, to nominate Mr. Chekun to the first deputy minister position in the Ministry for Crimea. He is an alternative candidature because he is known by many people in Crimea and in Ukraine, and I hope for support. Thank you, Mr. Eldar. This is our first meeting. Today we start a cycle, a series of meetings of civil activists and the representatives of governmental authorities so that we can develop proposals and narrative and dialogue which will allow us to accelerate the movement towards the occupation of Crimea and to make this day when Crimea will rejoin Ukraine again to become close. Thank you.